President-elect Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos.
President Marcos taps Philippine Solicitor General Jose Calida as the next head of the Commission on Audit.
The online news agency Rappler to appeal the closure order against it by the Philippine Securities and Exchange Commission.
And a former White House aide reveals former U.S. President Trump tried to join Capitol Hill rioters January last year.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, survivors of the Philippine martial law period puzzled and dismayed that the Supreme Court junked their petition to stop Ferdinand Marcos Jr. from becoming president. The president-elect believes the tribunal's ruling should now end all doubts on his eligibility to run for the nation's highest post. Mike Navallo has tonight's top story.
It came as no surprise, but martial law survivors are still baffled by the Supreme Court ruling junking their plea to disqualify President-elect Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. The group campaign against the return of the Marcoses and martial law or karma asks, isn't the failure to file income tax returns a legal or moral issue, especially for government officials and those running for office? The group says it's difficult to understand that the High Court decided Marcos did not violate the law in not paying taxes, that he did not commit a crime involving moral turpitude, and that he could go scot-free for his past conviction. The group asserts it's not just a legal issue, but a moral and historical one. It adds the people just lost a battle for truth and justice in allowing an allegedly proven tax evader and convicted criminal to rule the land. But for attorney Estelito Mendoza, Marcos's lawyer, they anticipated the ruling.
We explained that there was no false statement in the certificate of candidacy, and the COMELEC first in division and then in bank sustained our position. We did in fact foresee, because we're convinced that the petitions were without merit. Mm-hmm. Now the belief has been vindicated by a 13th vote.
Mendoza did not directly answer what the impact might be of the Supreme Court ruling on ordinary citizens who pay their taxes and file their income tax returns regularly. But Mendoza defended his client on another issue, the non-payment of estate tax. Mendoza says it's possible the tax collection as prescribed, although the government had long started collecting billions of unpaid estate taxes. He asserts it's not Marcos himself who is liable.
The taxes are levied not on the persons constituting the heirs, but on the properties constituting the estate.
What's clear from the Supreme Court ruling, Mendoza says, is that the Supreme Court considered the impending oath-taking of Marcos on Thursday.
What is at stake is the confidence of the people as to the legitimacy, appropriateness of the assumption of office to move of Bongbong Marcos of the presidency. But that is to be expected because of the incredible margin of victory.
Mendoza urged the public to respect his client's win. In his visit to Cebu Tuesday, Marcos welcomed the Supreme Court ruling.
At least that clears all of the, that removes all of the questions that they have raised as to my my qualification to run for president at all. So we knew it was coming. We didn't know it would come now.
Former COMELEC Chair Saidamin Pangarungan also hailed the decision, which he says will finally put to rest questions on the eligibility of Marcos and the validity of his certificate of candidacy. But for martial law survivors, Marcos's legitimacy will remain in question amid all the historical distortions and false narratives and the grand promise of economic recovery. They vow they will continue to hold the Marcoses accountable for the plunder, corruption, human rights abuses, and other forms of social injustices in their 21 years in power. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines on the eve of change as it prepares to install its new leader on Thursday. Organizers and security forces have completed their preparations for the inauguration of President-elect Marcos Jr. Raya Capulong reports.
A final rehearsal for the program and the military and civic parade was held Wednesday morning, a day before the inauguration of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. During the rehearsal, there was a simulation of the arrival and the inauguration of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. TV host actress Tony Gonzaga rehearsed the Philippine National Anthem, while Chris Villonco, together with the Young Voices of the Philippines Choir, rehearsed their number, Ang Pilipinas Kong Mahal. Meanwhile, a military parade includes a flyby of government air assets, medical frontliners, athletes, workers from transport sector, agriculture, and others also joined the rehearsal.
It's 95% there. Oh, as you can see, konting doon sa stage, konting tweaking na lang. But you saw the run through, and people-wise, alam na nila kung ano yung gagawin nila. Just really the... itong technicals na lang, and hopefully makisama yung weather.
The Philippine National Police reminds the militant groups they can only hold demonstrations in freedom parks.
Gusto natin gawin nila ito sa tamang lugar. Ito yung Freedom Park. Mm-hmm. Now we have identified four. Meron dyan yung Liwasang Bonifacio. Andyan din yung Plaza Miranda, Plaza Moriones, at Plaza Dilao.
The police will be implementing a strict screening process to the public who will watch the inauguration.
Kung hindi maiwasan dahil sa pagdadala ng extra na damit, pamaypay, tubig, and other personal belongings, ay gumamit na lamang po ng plastic bag para makita kaagad ng ating mga kapulisan.
Motorists are also advised to avoid the streets around the National Museum and take alternate routes to avoid traffic. Raya Capulong, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine Vice President-elect Sara Duterte is greeted by foreign dignitaries who are attending Thursday's inaugural ceremony. Duterte met in Pasay City with U.S. Second Gentleman Douglas M. Hoff, who relayed the congratulations of his wife, Vice President Kamala Harris, and from U.S. President Biden. M. Hoff is leading Washington's delegation to the Marcos inauguration. Manila's envoy to Washington, Jose Manuel Romualdez, says Vice President Duterte is expected to visit the U.S. in September. She's attending an education summit in New York at the sidelines of the U.N. General Assembly.
Sabi ko nga kay Vice President, we need you in Washington para yung ating relationship mas lalo pang gaganda. Very articulate si Vice President in telling the Second Gentleman in his party that the relationship is really good and strong, and that she looks forward to going to the United States sometime this year.
Aside from M. Hoff, the Vice Presidents of China and Vietnam and Japan's Foreign Minister also met with the Vice President-elect on Wednesday.
Philippine Solicitor General Jose Calida is tapped to head the Commission on Audit in the new Marcos administration. Calida has been the government's top lawyer since 2016. He previously served as Justice Undersecretary and Executive Director of the Dangerous Drugs Board. Meanwhile, President-elect Marcos Jr. named veteran banker Jose Arnulfo Veloso as the head of the government service insurance system. Veloso says it's a privilege for him to be of service to the agency and the nation. He previously served as president and CEO of the Philippine National Bank and as president of the Bankers Association of the Philippines. Philippine Vice President Leni Robredo bade farewell to her staff Wednesday as she recalled the memorable moments of her six-year term. Adrian Ayalin with this story.
Vice President Leni Robredo has no regrets for the 6 years she spent in public office. Despite all the difficulties she and her staff encountered,
Chair
leading to her heartbreaking loss in the 2022 presidential elections.
Kahit hindi ako nanalo, if I have to do it all over again, knowing what the results will be, I will still do it.
Robredo is proud of the accomplishments of her office, from its livelihood programs to COVID-19 initiatives, proving that she was not only a spare tire for the past 6 years.
Converting the office of the Vice President from a mere ceremonial one into an advocacy heavy one, yun yung number one. Kasi yung core na ngayon ng programa, talagang mag-transform ng mga communities through our programs.
Robredo says her 19-day stint as co-chairperson of the Interagency Committee Against Illegal Drugs was among her memorable experiences. She also welcomes consistent recognitions from the Commission on Audit. For the fourth straight year, the OVP received from COA an unqualified opinion, which is granted to government agencies that have fairly presented their financial reports and statements.
The 6 years namin sa OVP, kasi talagang we tried our hardest na gawing parang model office yung OVP. So aside from the ISO certification, nare-recertify kami every year.
While Robredo and some of her staff members will be launching the non-government organization Angat Buhay on Friday, she is looking forward to having more personal time as an ordinary citizen.
Makakapanood na ulit ako ng mga K-drama after tomorrow. Mababasa ko na yung lahat na librong naghihintay basahin. Pero yung malungkot for me, yung mga taong iiwan. Hindi iiwan, pero mas mara... Yung mga taong may iwan sa OVP, syempre mamimiss namin sila.
Robredo's official portrait was hung at the OVP along with other past vice presidents. As she left her office in Quezon City for the last time, she was gifted with applause from supporters and a snappy salute from her security detail. Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
Key officials of China and Japan visit Philippine President Duterte on the eve of his departure from office. Duterte met at the Villamore Air Base in Pasay with Chinese Vice President Wong Kwi-shan and Japanese Foreign Minister Yoshimasa Hayashi. The two are in the country for the Marcos inaugural. Also on Wednesday, Duterte attended a Thanksgiving celebration of his ruling political party, the PDP Laban. Philippine President-elect Marcos Jr. vows to run after officials tagged by an intelligence report in the alleged smuggling of agricultural products. Robert Mano reports.
In his visit to Cebu Tuesday for the oath-taking of winning candidates for one Cebu political party, President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. said he will track down those involved in agricultural smuggling. This after outgoing Senate President Vicente Soto III handed him a copy of the Senate Committee Report on Agri-Smuggling. Marcos has said he will head the Agriculture Department.
We're going to run after them. Hapulin natin lahat yan.
Customs Commissioner Ray Leonardo Guerrero, who was among the 22 individuals implicated in the committee report as protector or agri-smuggler, was dismayed. His challenge now to his accuser, file the appropriate cases in court.
Diyos ko naman, dalawang araw lang, isang araw lang actually, di ba? Tapos nun, may call for me to resign. Alam nyo, ang dali mag-resign. Ang tanong ay, sino papalit? Sino magpapatuloy ng trabaho?
Guerrero adds attacking the Customs Bureau's credibility will only benefit the smugglers. The Department of Agriculture, for its part, said it is also investigating smuggling allegations.
More or less the same po, but medyo yung nasa Senate investigation are quite marami. Hindi naman po ganong encompassing yung investigation we are conducting.
Yeah, Agriculture Secretary William Dar said he will let the Presidential Anti-Corruption Commission and the Office of the Ombudsman do their mandates to investigate DA officials.
Wala pong katotohanan yan. Alam mo, nung pagdating ko talaga binalasa ko kasi maraming reports na ganun nga nangyayari.
Meanwhile, Senator Soto confirmed that the list came from the National Intelligence Coordinating Agency. The Samahang Industriya ng Agrikultura or SINAG is not satisfied with the list. SINAG Chairman Rosendo So insists more individuals should be included.
Dapat yung head ng TA, nakikita namin, dapat kasama kasi yung first border control, pagpasok ng kargamento. Ang nauuna kasi is DA. Mukhang bitin din yung Senate hearing dahil hindi na imbita yung mga ibang personalidad.
So also urged the government officials identified in the Senate list to resign. Robert Mano, ABS-CBN News.
Up ahead, shocking revelations from a former White House aide on President Trump's actions during last year's Capitol Hill riot.
The World Tonight returns after the break.
We're back on The World Tonight. The Philippines' corporate regulator moves to shut down Rappler, the online news agency led by Nobel laureate Maria Ressa. It's seen as another blow to press freedom by the Duterte administration a day before it relinquishes power.
Days before the Duterte administration ends, the Securities and Exchange Commission released a decision upholding its order to shut down online news website Rappler. The commission affirmed its earlier decision to declare void Rappler's Philippine Depositary Receipts, or PDRs, and revoke the certificates of incorporation of Rappler Incorporated and Rappler Holdings Corporation. The PDR is a method for businessmen, whether a Filipino or foreigner, to invest in a company without controlling the company. But the SEC believes Rappler violated constitutional restrictions on foreign companies owning media organizations in the country when it received PDRs from Omidyar Network. The SEC insists a provision in the PDR which required the Filipino stockholders of Rappler to seek the approval of Omidyar on fundamental corporate matters is a clear violation of the constitutional restrictions on foreign control of mass media. It adds the subsequent donation of Omidyar of its PDRs did not cure Rappler Inc.'s violation. Rappler's lawyer says they will appeal the decision, adding the company can continue operating while the order is on appeal.
We have 15 days, I think, from yesterday to file a petition for review or what we, the layman, know, appeal to the Court of Appeals. From the Court of Appeals, we will have a chance to file a motion for reconsideration with the Court of Appeals in case the Court of Appeals disagreed with us. And eventually, we will have the final opportunity to appeal all the way up to the Supreme Court. So it's not the end of the world for us.
Lim, who was once the president and CEO of the Philippine Stock Exchange, explains PDRs and shares of stock are different.
I've come from the stock exchange, and there is a very big difference between depositary receipts and shares of stock. Okay, so that's one area of contention.
In case the SEC insists on a shutdown, Rappler says it is ready to seek a temporary restraining order from the courts. Rappler founder and CEO Maria Ressa is currently in Honolulu, Hawaii. She said it would be business as usual for Rappler.
We continue to hold the line, we'll continue to report, and we'll continue to demand that access is there.
She also has this appeal to the incoming president.
I continue to appeal to work to the incoming administration, work with journalists. We're here to help you give a better future for the Philippines. We're not your enemies.
The New York-based Human Rights Watch branded the SEC order as a form of government retaliation against Rappler's fearless reporting on the human rights abuses in Duterte's drug war. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines also standing with Rappler, saying the Duterte administration has been using lawsuits and regulatory processes as tools to muzzle the press for the past 6 years. Senator Risa Ontiveros adding her voice, calling the order deplorable. She points out, while many registered news outfits are being crushed, unaccountable and insensitive vloggers have been given accreditation to cover the most important events in government. Bayan Muna Chairperson Neri Corminares warns the shutdown of media institutions like Rappler further destroys the country's pillars for checks and balances. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine media groups question new rules of the country's telecom regulator, which restrict the block time deals of radio and television stations. Johnson Manabat has the details.
In its memorandum order dated June 23rd, the Philippine National Telecommunications Commission, or NTC, restricted the amount of airtime that a radio or television station can sell to block timers to just 50% of their daily airtime. The memo was signed by NTC Commissioner Gamalier Cordova, requiring all television and radio stations to submit block time agreements for their approval prior to the implementation of such agreements. According to the NTC, all broadcast entities shall be liable with the block timer for any violation committed by the block timer. Former Movie Television Review and Classification Board, or MTRCB Chairman Attorney Toto Villarreal, questioned the memorandum, saying it seems to violate the Constitution that guarantees press freedom and freedom of expression.
Ang isang circular na gaya nito na kumbaga ay may mga restrictions bago ka palang kumilos, tinatawag itong prior restraint. At sinasabi nga na ang ganitong klaseng restraint ay nagpo-provide ng isang chilling effect doon sa mga engaged sa industry, sa mga namamahayag, yung gumagawa ng mga palabas.
The memo was also a surprise to the kapisanan ng mga broadcaster ng Pilipinas, or KBP. KBP President Herman Basbanyo said there was no hearing or consultation with stakeholders prior to the issuance of the memorandum.
We will oppose in the industry, in the KBP especially.
Basbanyo believes, aside from the issue of constitutionality, the memo will have an effect not only on media organizations, but on the public as well.
Well, alam natin na may issue ito ng constitutionality, prior restraint, and of course, yung freedom to express oneself, freedom of the press. Alam natin na hindi naman ito dapat, at malaki yung impact nito sa industriya. Big networks, small, medium-sized networks, ay may impact ito sa ating mga, even sa mga mamamayan. Kasi may option ka na mapakinggan yung maraming ideya, maraming programa, kung may mga block times din, di ba? So may effect din to sa audience.
Under the block time agreement, media entity can sell their airtime to a third party.
Alam naman natin na prerogative ng mga estasyon o mga network ang model ng kanilang programa. So, matagal nang ginagawa yon at nangyayari, napinapayagan naman yon.
Meanwhile, the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines believes the NTC memorandum has no legal basis and contradicts NTC Commissioner Gamalier Cordova's own statement before the House of Representatives that it has no power to regulate content and block time agreements. KBP is planning to file their position paper before the NTC on the scheduled July 11th hearing. Johnson Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
A Philippine health official defends the government's decision to keep Metro Manila under the least stringent COVID alert level despite a recent rise in infections. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says Filipinos should already learn to live with a coronavirus. But she reminds Filipinos to remain cautious. Vergere cites the public's increased mobility as one of the contributing factors to the uptick in cases.
Yun, hindi na ho tayo nandun sa direksyon na gusto natin magsasara, magbubukas. Ang sa atin po, tinuturuan natin ang ating mga kababayan that we should live with this virus. Kailangan protektahan natin ang ating sarili by receiving our vaccines and also doing and complying our safety protocols katulad po ng pagmamask. Gusto ko lang hong paalalahanan ng ating mga kababayan ang atin po talagang contributing factors ngayon kung bakit tayo ay nagkakaroon ng mas mataas na kaso, nagkakahawa-hawaan. It's because of our mobility patterns, yun pong atin pong mababang vaccine uptake, especially for our booster shots, at saka yung pagsunod po natin sa minimum public health standards.
The Philippine Health Department recorded 781 new COVID cases Wednesday, with nearly a dozen new fatalities. This brings the total number of active cases to more than 7,000, the highest since April 29.
Schools in the Philippine city of Cebu can now fully implement face-to-face classes. Mayor Michael Rama signed an executive order Wednesday allowing the conduct of in-person classes at all levels. But it still requires strict compliance with minimum health standards such as the use of face masks and physical distancing. The order also specifies special vaccination days for schools and universities. Mayor Rama previously opposed an order by Cebu Governor Gwen Garcia to require face masks only in closed and air-conditioned areas.
Explosive testimony from a former White House aide in the U.S. House probe into the January 2021 Capitol Hill riot. Cassidy Hutchinson claims then-President Trump tried to grab control of his limousine in a bid to drive towards the Capitol and join his supporters. The assistant to Trump's chief of staff said the president had demanded to march with a crowd. Hutchinson's testimony is the first blow-by-blow account of activity inside the White House on the day of the riot. She says Trump and some of his top advisors were aware of the possibility of violence, contradicting claims the assault on the Capitol was spontaneous.
I was in the vicinity of a conversation where I overheard the president say something to the effect of, you know, I don't effing care that they have weapons. They're not here to hurt me. Take the effing mags away. Let my people in. They can march to the Capitol from here. Let the people in. Take the mags away.
As an American, I was disgusted. It was unpatriotic. It was un-American. We were watching the Capitol building get defaced over a lie.
Trump used his social media network to dismiss Hutchinson's claims as a fake story and to denounce the House hearing as a kangaroo court. Six public hearings by the House panel have outlined its initial finding that Trump led a criminal conspiracy to overturn his defeat to Joe Biden.
The United Kingdom imposes more sanctions on Russia for its invasion of Ukraine. And Indonesia's President Joko Widodo tries to broker peace between the leaders of Ukraine and Russia. The details in this report.
Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky urges the United Nations to visit the site of a deadly missile strike on a shopping mall in the city of Kremenchuk. Speaking at the emergency session of the UN Security Council, Zelensky says the UN can send a representative to independently confirm that Russia was indeed responsible for the attack on the building, which left at least 18 people dead and dozens others missing. The United Kingdom announces more sanctions against Russian citizens and companies, including some described as members of Russian President Vladimir Putin's inner circle. Among those sanctioned is Vladimir Potanin, a supporter of Russia's leader and described by the British government as Russia's second richest man. His estimated net worth, nearly $16 billion. Meanwhile, Indonesian President Joko Widodo is on his way to Kiev. He departed Poland Tuesday evening. He is expected to meet with Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky before heading to Moscow to meet with Putin. Jokowi will try to establish dialogue between the two leaders and seek an end to the fighting.
The three-day rally of the Philippine Bourse loses steam amid fresh worries over global growth. The details in this report.
Philippine shares pulled back again on Wednesday alongside most Asian markets amid persistent growth concerns. The peso also breached the 55 level against the U.S. dollar for the second time this week and closed at 55.06. For the day, the PSE index shed nearly 0.75% at 6,303. In corporate stories, it looks like it's finally all systems go for Philex Mining's delayed 3.15 billion peso stock rights offer for next month, as it has already received the certificate of permit to offer securities for sale from regulators. The Pangilinan-led mining company plans to sell up to 842 million shares at a maximum price of 4 pesos and 81 cents a piece. Volatile market conditions earlier forced Philex to defer SRO plans. Funds raised will be used to launch the $224 million Silangan mine in Surigao del Norte, known as one of the largest mining projects in the country. The target to begin commercial operations by 2025. The mine is expected to generate some $7 billion in sales of minerals throughout its 28-year lifespan. The mining industry has enjoyed tailwinds from higher levels of metal prices and a more friendly government policy. Meanwhile, Boulevard Holdings clarifies why it has decided to keep Friday's Boracay closed despite the heavy foot traffic on the island. BHI says it won't open up just to earn run-of-the-mill return based on cutthroat room rates of just 5 to 8,000 a night, since it's already investing a lot to reposition itself to the 12 to 20,000 a night segment. For now, it is focused on upgrading its rooms, fixtures, furniture, fittings, and equipment. The group plans to reopen by September this year to take advantage of the expected influx of foreign visitors by the last quarter. So far, it's the domestic tourists driving foot traffic.
The Philippine peso continues its steep decline. It settled at 55.06 to the dollar on Wednesday, marking its weakest showing in over 16 years. The peso has been losing ground against the greenback since the start of the year. Incoming Philippine Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla downplays the peso's depreciation, which he attributes to the strengthening of the dollar. But he admits the central bank will participate in the market to address excessive short-term volatility.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Patti LaBelle. Every exit is an entrance to someplace else.
And that is The World Tonight, the 29th of June, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!
I'm Amy Mitchell, and I'm a mom. I had my first kid when I was 20 years old, and I've been running late ever since. My days are filled with dropping